A researcher, while conducting a research, is interested in finding out some new things. While finding this out, he or she cannot study the whole population, but they select only a small sample. And now, from this sample, they would like to generalize. This generalizability of a sample, of a tool, of your results is what is more important for the researcher. We will see today what is statistics, what is parameter, and how a researcher can generalize from his or her mean of the sample to the population. And for this, we must know various concepts. Let us see them one by one. The statistical inference means a researcher is inferring from the statistics to the parameters. What is statistics? Statistics refers to the facts related to the sample. The mean and other related measures of the sample are called statistics. And the mean and other related measures of the population are called parameters. We generally infer about the population because we don't study the whole population except a census, because in census what is expected? The whole population of the country is taken into consideration. But otherwise, most of the studies we do with the sample. So we are inferring from the measures of sample about the population. The measures of population are called parameters. The statistics that is related to the sample is supposed to be fluctuating. Because if you take another sample, it will not be the same, there will be some fluctuation. So statistics fluctuates. But the parameters of a population are thought to be a fixed thing because they are inferred. They are not variable. Variable are the samples. And from the sample, we infer about the population. We have to understand both these concepts very well. Because when we infer, you must know how you are inferring, why you are inferring, and in what way the implications of this inference are. As we know, the primary objective of the research is to infer about the population from the sample, which is a part of that population. So we take a small part which we think is representative of the population. We work on that sample. And then we say, if the sample is showing this, then the population also must be showing this. With what confidence we can say this, we will see that today. This confidence or this degree to which your sample mean is representative of your population mean shows its trustworthiness, shows its significance. That is why we have to be extra careful in selecting a sample. We use the word significant. In normal English, significant means important. But in statistics, significant does not mean important. It means probably true. When you are saying the difference is significant, we mean that it is probably true. If you are saying it is highly significant, doesn't mean it is highly important. It means the probability of being true is more. We must understand this in regular English and in statistics, the meaning of the word significant differs. The research finding may be true, but may not be important. We must understand this. In principle, the result which is significant, this means that it is not attributed to a chance. We are saying this result is not because of chance. It is not because of fluke. We have done a serious work. And if I do it again and again, it will be the same. So when I am saying it is significant, I am not attributing it to a chance. Now when the researcher is interested in inferring from the statistics about the parameters, about the population, we must know if there are any errors. Now for means, if you want to infer from sample mean, about the population mean, we must know a concept which is called standard error of mean. Let us see what is this concept is about. The standard error of the mean, which is written as SE of mean, SEM, quantifies the precision of the mean. Precision means accuracy of the mean. SE of mean is a measure which tells you how far your sample mean is away from the population mean. We assume that there is a population mean. We do not know exactly where the population mean lies. So we assume that population mean is here and your sample mean is here, or your sample mean is here. How far it is? It should be nearer to population mean. That is what the researcher aims at. But he or she must know how far it is from the expected population mean. So what we say, this is called standard error of mean. How far the mean of sample lies from the mean of population. The standard error of mean helps you to estimate the variability. Variability of from the population mean. Now if you take 100 samples, representative samples from the population, you will have 100 means. Now, are they same? They are not expected to be same because there will be variation, a small variation. This variation from the population mean is given by the standard error of mean. It will tell you how the sample means differ, how they are varied, how far they are from the population mean. You have already studied about variability. Variability of a sample, we call it standard deviation, and we denote it by SD or sigma. Standard deviation tells you how far your scores are varied, scattered from your mean. Suppose you have 50 students in your class and you give them a mathematics test of say 50 marks. The average is 40. But everyone has not got 40 marks. Some have got 43, some have got 48, some have got 2, some have got 0, some have got 10. So now if you have range from 0 to 48 and your mean is 40. Now how far they are varied from the mean, this is called variability. So we use standard deviation. That is for the sample. Now for the population, we don't use standard deviation, we use standard error of mean. So in effect, it is also a standard deviation, but it is standard deviation of the population mean. Just to brush up your information about standard deviation, please see this diagram. In this diagram, it is shown that if it is normally distributed, your population is normally distributed, then you will have 68% of the cases which lie between 1 SD plus to 1 SD minus. So your mean is in between, and on the left hand side you have minus 1 standard deviation, and on the right hand side you have plus 1 standard deviation. Within this, 68% of your cases lie. So this is normal distribution, is not scattered to a great extent. If you see the next diagram, you will see that if it is a normally distributed population, then from plus 2 to minus 2 standard deviation from mean, almost 95% cases are covered. If you see a diagram on the left hand side, you will see those cases are scattered. That means SD is very high. It is not normally distributed sample. We will keep this concept in mind about standard deviation, because we have said earlier that standard error of mean is also a type of standard deviation, but it is standard deviation of the population. Here you will see two different formula. One is for ungrouped data and other is for grouped data. Ungrouped data means you have 50 cases and you have not grouped them. So each independent case you are seeing. Now you have to find out the mean, you have to find out the deviation from the mean and square it. And all these deviation squares are added. That is called summation of x square. Now if you see the formula for ungrouped data, you will see the standard deviation sigma is equal to square root of summation x square upon n. N is the total number. If you group that data, that means you have class intervals, you will use a little different formula. That is sigma is equal to square root of summation of fx square upon n. F is a frequency. You multiply that frequency and the deviation and then add it. Keep this in mind. This is about standard deviation of a sample. We are going to study about standard error of mean. And I've said earlier that standard error of mean is a form of standard deviation, but not of a sample, but of population. Now the researcher is interested in estimating the population mean from the sample mean. You have to understand this concept very well. The researcher does not know population mean. Suppose in a school you have 10 divisions of standard 8, that means population is 8 standard population is all those 10 divisions. And every division has say 60 students. So the population of 8 standard students is 600. But you are not studying 600, you are studying only a one class, or you may study only 20 out of that class. So now you have a sample mean of those 20 students. You want to estimate about the whole 8 standard student group, that is 600, that's a population. You do not have population mean because you have not worked with population. We have worked only on a sample. Now the researcher is estimating the population mean from the sample he or she has studied. Now this standard error of mean helps you to estimate this, gives you understanding how far you are correct in estimating the population mean. Please understand that we are only estimating because we do not know exactly population mean. Otherwise, we would have studied population. We are not able to study population because population is huge. It is spread. It will take a lot of time. It will take a lot of money. So we do not study the whole population. We take random sample. As far as possible, we take representative sample so that the generalizability of sample to population is high. Here, this standard error of mean helps you to estimate how far your sample mean estimates the population mean. So if you have lower value of standard error, that means you are estimating in a very confident manner. But if you take a small sample, it will vary. And that's why your estimation may go wrong. We have seen that larger the standard deviation of your sample, standard deviation is large, that means your scores are scattered. They are far away from mean. And there are many scores which are away from mean. So if your SD is larger, that means your standard error also will be large. If your standard error of large, we have seen that smaller standard error will give you correct estimation. The bigger figure, the larger SEFM will not give you the correct figure of estimation of your population mean. That means as far as possible, you must select a representative sample which is homogeneous. This fault also can be corrected by increasing the size of the sample. If you take 15 and try to estimate about 600, it may not be highly significant. But if you take 150, that may give you a confidence more than the previous one. So if we take a larger sample, the SD comes down, and that means the standard error is also less, so that you can estimate the population mean with greater confidence. The standard error of mean, as we designate standard deviation by sigma, here also we can designate SE with a sigma and we write M. That means it is standard error of mean. So we will use sigma m. We have also said sigma m is the standard deviation of sample means. Again, we are not taking 100 samples. We are only thinking, if I had taken 100 samples, what would be my standard error of mean? The formula for the standard error of the mean is sigma m is equal to sigma upon square root of n, where sigma is the standard deviation of the original distribution and n is the sample size. Now if you see this formula, square root of n is denominator. If it is large, that means your figure of SEM will be smaller. That means if you take larger sample, standard error will be less. And we know that standard error is less, that means your estimation of population mean is high. So one way to have more confidence is increase the sample size. Similarly, if you see the formula again, you are having the standard deviation of the mean is numerator and you want smaller SEM. So naturally you would like to have small SD. Sigma should be small. That means standard deviation should be small, which means the scatter should not be more. Scatter should be less, nearer to the mean. Then only your SD will be small. Otherwise SD will be big because your scores are scattered to a great height from the mean. If you want to keep this SEM value small, then you have the numerator small or you have N large. So you take larger sample or you take representative sample which is not scattered to a great extent. We are talking about inferences. To infer from sample mean about the population mean. Now we have also said that we are confident in saying that this is not by chance. This is by planning. And these are the results which we will get when, can I say that even if I do this 100 times, I am confident that every sample will give me the same results. We are not so confident. So what we do, we take confidence levels or we take confidence intervals. Within this interval, the mean will lie. I am not saying mean will be exactly 16.5. I would say that the mean would lie between 15.5 to 17.5. But yes, actual mean, sample mean was 16.5. And I am saying that population mean may lie between 15.5 to 16.8 or 16 point whatever. With what confidence I am saying this? This is called confidence level. And the confidence interval will give you two figures to tell you that your population mean will lie between these two figures. Let us see what is confidence interval. Confidence interval tells you how precisely you are estimating the population mean from your sample mean. The fundamental idea of statistics is to infer from your sample mean about the population mean. I am repeating it again and again because it is a very important concept. The researcher does not know population mean. He or she only has a sample mean. Now, this is called statistics. So, from statistics, we are inferring about the population. And with what confidence? This confidence interval is called CI, is given by interval of two scores. If the sample is small and variable, that means the scores are scattered, then there is a likelihood that the population mean will be far away from your sample mean. If the sample is large and less scattered, the probability is that your sample mean estimates population mean correctly. That means it is nearer to population mean. The confidence interval will be smaller. So there are two variables. One is sample size, N. And other is variability, scatteredness, that is standard deviation. So deviation from mean. So using these two statistics, we compute the confidence interval. It is interval, that means it is a range. It gives you a range of scores from this to that. And your population mean will fall in between. Can we estimate the population mean with 100% confidence? I don't think so, because even if you take a representative sample, even if you take a random sample, it may not be exactly like population, because population is vast. It's 10,000, 1 lakh, 10 lakh persons in the population, and we are taking only say 100, 500, 1000. This sample is a representative sample, but still there will be some error. So we generally do not say with 100% confidence, but we can say with 99% confidence. We can also say by 95% of confidence. And there is nothing authentic or great about this. You can also take 90% confidence, you can take 80% confidence. But you see that your confidence level is going down. Generally, people take, the researchers accept two confidence levels, that is 99% and 95%. Let us see what it means. When I say I am 95% confident, which means if I conduct experiment 100 times or if I conduct this survey 100 times with different samples, 95% of the time I will get the same results and 5% by chance. 99% confidence level means if I conduct this survey or experiment 100 times, I will have 100 means and I am sure that 99% of the time I will get the similar results. Only 1% is by chance. We have seen earlier that when I use the word significant, I am not attributing this to the chance. 99% of the time I am confident that we will get the same results. 1% may be by chance. Keep this in mind when we are estimating our population mean from the sample mean. The 95% confidence interval is a range of values that you can be 95% certain that it contains the true mean of the population. We know that 95% of cases lie within plus or minus 1.96 into standard error of mean. And we also know that 99% cases lie within plus or minus 2.58 into AC of mean. You have to refer to table A in any statistic book. It will tell you the spread in normal probability curve. Now these are the limits. If we take 95% confidence interval, that means mean plus or minus 1.96 into standard error of mean. So you will get mean plus this and mean minus this. So this is a confidence interval. Similarly, for 99% confidence level, mean plus or minus 2.58 into standard error of mean. So mean plus 2.58 standard error of mean and mean minus 2.58 standard error of mean. This will again give you two values that will show you the range of values within which your population mean will lie. We have seen that 95% of the time your population mean will lie within this and 1% of the time you may be wrong or 5% of the time you may be wrong. Now let us see this with one example. The mean of a reading comprehension for 225 students of 8th standard of a school ABC was 27.26 and SD was 11.20. How dependable is this mean for all the 8th standard students of this school ABC? In this school, it's not only 225, they have more than 800 students in standard 8. So that becomes the population. Now we have to estimate only by studying 225 students, you have got a mean. How this mean is dependable about all the students, that is about the population. So we are estimating population mean, that is called MPOP. It is written like MPOP. So now we have to find out the confidence intervals because we have already said there is no fixed value of mean population because we are not sure, we do not know, we are not studying the whole population, it is only estimation. So we will tell about the range with confidence, with 95% confidence, this is the range within which the mean population will lie. This is the confidence interval with 99% confidence within which the mean population lie. Let us see how to do this. We know the formula of standard error of mean is SD upon square root of n. So standard deviation is given here 11.20 divided by square root of n. N is 225, that is 15. So you get SD as 0.75. Now we have to find out the mean population. We know that mean population is mean plus or minus 1.96 into ACM. Let us substitute the values. Mean is 27.26 plus or minus 1.96 multiplied by 0.75, that is AC of mean. 27.26 plus or minus 1.47, which is giving you two values. If you add to it, it is 28.73. If you subtract from it, it is 25.79. So now the range or confidence interval is 25.79 to 28.73. What does it mean? That with 95% confidence, I am saying that mean population will lie between 25.73 to 28.73. My sample mean was of 225 students was 27.26. Now, if you want to find out with 99% confidence level, we use the formula that mean pop is equal to mean of sample plus or minus 2.58 multiplied by ACM. We already know ACM value is 0.75. So you substitute those values and you get confidence interval as 25.32 to 29.23. What does this mean? That with 99% confidence, I am saying the population mean will lie between 25.32 to 29.23. My sample mean was 27.26. Now let us compare these two. At 95% confidence level, the mean population lies between 25.79 to 28.73. At 99% confidence level, mean population lies between 25.32 to 29.23. Do you see that as your confidence level increases from 95 to 99, your range also increases. If you want to be less confident, you have smaller size of interval. But if you want to be more confident at 99% of the time, then the confidence interval range increases. We have already said that as far as possible we should avoid small sample. But if you have small sample, then you have to make corrections in your formula. AC of M, while calculating standard error of mean with small sample, there is a specific formula for it. Instead of taking sigma, we take small s. So it is denoted like this: S of mean, that means standard error of mean with small sample, is equal to standard deviation of that mean upon square root of n. Now this standard deviation which you are talking about of that small sample also has a different formula, where you don't take n but you take n minus 1. That is a correction we have to make when we take small sample. But we have to keep in mind, as far as possible, we should avoid taking small samples. Inferences drawn from small samples are not usually satisfactory. We know that because the sample may not be representative of the whole population. So generalizability of a sample gets threatened. There is one more concept which we must know while using the statistics and conducting the inference. That concept is degrees of freedom. If you see the statistical table, you will see that there is, in the first column, you have degrees of freedom. Now, what is degrees of freedom? It is a freedom given to you, but how many degrees, how much freedom you have to infer or to interpret? When a statistics is used to estimate a parameter, the number of degrees of freedom, which is denoted as DF, available depends upon the restrictions placed upon the observations. So one DF is lost for each restriction imposed. Whenever a statistics is used to estimate a population, the DF is available is n minus 1. N is total number and one restriction is generally put, so n minus 1. I'll give you one example, what is degrees of freedom. Suppose you have four figures, data of four people, 10, 20, 30 and 40. What is the mean? It is 25. Now, if you have to change figures to get 25 as the mean, how many figures can you change? You can change first three, any three figures you can change, but the fourth one you cannot change because the total should be 100. Then only your mean will be 25. So total n was 4 and restriction is put on 1, that is n minus 1. So what is the degrees of freedom? 3. So you can change three figures in order to get mean as 25. But the fourth one you cannot change. It will be decided by the first three. You cannot change that as per your will. First three you can change a 9, you can change a 100, you can change a 50. But the fourth one will be decided by the first three. Because we know the total should be 100 divided by 4 is 25. The mean is 25. So we have put restriction, one restriction. That is why the degrees of freedom is n minus 1 is 3. So n minus 1 is 3 means what? You can change 3 figures. Restriction is on 1. But is it always so? It is not always so. If you are working with statistics like ANOVA, that example was of mean where you have only one set of scores. But when you are using ANOVA or ANCOVA, you have a table which is 2 by 2 or 3 by 2. Now see this example, it is a 3 by 2 table. That means socioeconomic status is high, medium and low. Whereas scholastic achievement has two aspects, that is high and low. So the table is 3 by 2. You have cases in 6 cells. While finding out ANOVA, what will be your degrees of freedom? Now you have 6 groups, but you don't have freedom for changing all 6. What is the degrees of freedom? N minus 1. Here we see that there are 3 columns and 2 rows. So if we say N minus 1, we take N1 and N2. So we see that N1 minus 1 into N2 minus 1, that will give us the degrees of freedom. So 3 minus 1 into 2 minus 1, that becomes 2. So our degrees of freedom calculated is 2. Where do we use degrees of freedom? If you see the table in statistics books, where we see the statistical significance at 0.01 level or 0.05 level or 0.1 level, so that time we have to see the degrees of freedom. Calculating degrees of freedom is useful for taking the statistics of mean. We will look into other aspects of significance of statistics, because the researcher's interest is estimating from the sample about the population. And for this, many other concepts also need to be taken into care. Thank you.